says, even a king, when he's born as a child, there's no difference between that king and a slave. Because his understanding is not fruitful. We don't know. You don't know that he's a king. So what does a king do when his prince is born? That prince has all the authority as a king. That prince has all the authority, the appointing, everything he needs to do it. But his understanding that he don't understand who he is. So they sent him. Right? When the king has a born, when the king has a son, he's like, listen, he presents it. Come to here. Here's this is my prince. This is the heir to the throne. He said, listen, but what does he do? He turns it over to the tutors. The tutors take him. They teach him how to be a king. They teach him how to eat. They teach him how to talk. They teach him, educate him, right? They teach him all how to be a king. So then when it's time, when he comes back, he knows who he is. It's just like us. Once we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we have all the authority. We have all the power. Right? The Lord is our King. The Father is the King. I'm an heir of Christ, a joint heir to the kingdom of God. But my understanding is unfruitful. And we're tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Why? Because we don't know who we are. Right? This is where we're at. And so this is what I believe that the Lord has put us on here for such a time as this, 2022, right here in Colfax. Most of the people that we minister, and I'm saying this for those of you guys that haven't been here, I'm just laying a foundation before going to my church family. I was in a church for 17 years under a pastor, and I would have never been launched, but it took an apostle from the East Coast to come and launch us. Why? Because a pastoral anointing will never launch you. Pastoral anointing is like this. He'll cover you like this, keep you from the prophets. He'll keep you from the apostles. He'll protect you because he's afraid. Right? But under an apostolic anointing, you'll be taught identity. Kingship, priesthood.
Amen.
You'll see the devils get cast out. You'll see signs and wonders. Why? Because it's a kingship, an anointing. There's an anointing to set the captives free. There's an anointing because it flows down through the head. So I'm saying this because this is like the difference that you'll see here than any other place because there's a different anointing. So. Like I told, we were saying this a couple of years ago. I said, listen, if you're in the same place, I actually said, if you're here in 1 year, something's wrong. And Miss Shauna came. She's like, I've got to talk to you about this. you know how she does it. She's like, and I told her, if you're in the same place in 1 year, I'm not doing my job. You know what I mean? If you're not casting devils out in 1 year, I have a problem. Right? Because I haven't done what I was supposed to do. I haven't taught you what we're supposed to do. So, we're going to get ready. So tonight I'm going to talk about, I'll lay down a foundation. The only way that an enemy can stay, the only way that a demon can stay in your life is if there's any type of, if there's legal right. Okay? You lay hands on somebody, they cast out the devil, then guess what? There was no legal right. He was just a trespasser. And he's still a trespasser if you know who you are. Right? But tonight I want to talk about identificational repentance. If you guys are taking notes. Number one is sin, personal sin. But you guys have to write that down. These are ways the enemy can stay. Number one is personal sin. too is unforgiveness. Number three is iniquity. The difference between sin and iniquity. Sin is missing the mark. Iniquity is unrepented sin. That you keep doing what you're not supposed to do. Okay, what am I on for? Four is judgment. The way that you judge another person is the same way that the Lord is going to judge you. Are you judging too harshly? Are you giving grace? There needs to be grace. Because you need grace. Okay, in this house you'll hear legal right a lot. Doesn't make sense if Jesus came, paid the cost. You're like, man, well then what legal right is there? We can hit all five of these, but today I want to hit iniquity, which is iniquity in you and iniquity in your bloodline. Identificational repentance. Basically, if I break it down, it's repenting for who you identify with. Identificational repentance. Sometimes you don't want to identify. You know, you don't want to identify. You don't want to identify with your past. How many know that names mean everything? My last name is Delgado. Right? Somebody asked me, "Oh yeah, I need a table for two." Then what's your name? My name is Delgado. You know what I mean? My son's names are Delgado. My grandson's names are Delgado. That's huge. But also my father's name is Delgado. His father's name is Delgado. So I identify with that name, right? Well, today we're talking about identificational repentance. Now go ahead, let's go to Lamentations 5:7. It says this, our fathers sinned and are no more, but we bear their iniquity. Let me read that one more time. It says, our fathers sinned and are no more, but we bear their iniquity. What does that mean? That means that our fathers have sinned and are no more, but we bear their iniquity. We actually are carrying the iniquities of our fathers. Some tell you guys as we're praying for people. And that demon manifests, and he comes up to about right here, and it won't leave. What does that mean? I said, Julie, she says legal right. And it is legal right, but it's broad. Because then you're like, what the heck? What I've learned over the years is once it stops and it doesn't move, we got to stop and deal with the legal right. Sometimes it's unforgiveness. Well, 90% of the time it's unforgiveness. Once you deal with all that, then you got to go, well, boom, is there any sin? Is there any repentant sin in your life? There is, deal with that, and then what? And we find out that there's a sin in the bloodline. And so this is, I want to put a word to this, and it's called identificational repentance. Because of the legal right is too broad. And so when it's identificational repentance, so it's we got to identify with who we identify, we got to repent for. And so this Lamentations 5:7, it says, our fathers have sinned and are no more, but we bear their iniquity. Well, then guess what? We got to deal with what our fathers have done. Right? And so, sounds crazy, right? Let's go to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. To say amen when you got it. Okay. If my people who are called by my name, what people? The body of Christ, the covenant people. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves. To repent. Let me find that scripture. That's just you guys there? Okay. 7 verse 14. 2 Chronicles 7 verse 14. Here we go. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. It's huge. Foundational. Right? Why would the people have to stand in the gap on me? In Ezekiel, you should see the picture that she gave me. Right here. This morning, I mean not this morning, but right before church, and she shows me a wall with a hole in it. She's saying that when she was up here, she's like, we've got to stand in the gap. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and repent, right? And pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Okay, how do we apply that in our lives? When you're praying for somebody, and that demon is stuck right here, and you dealt with unforgiven, you dealt with the sin in their life, then you're like, what? Okay, let's see. We ask the Holy Spirit, is there anything else? Oh, well, my uncle did voodoo. My uncle did witchcraft. He worshipped, you know, he did this. He was in, you know, he was a Freemason. And I'm like, oh, snap. Well, guess what? Now you know. You stop right there and you deal with that identificational repentance. You deal with that sin to the Father. Why? Because legally, so this book is a book of law that applies in the courtroom of heaven. And because your forefathers sinned and they're no more, and we are bearing the iniquities, you have to go to heaven and you have to file a prayer. You have to file repentance. It's like, how many have been in court? How many of you guys have been in court? Don't be trying to lie. You know? When you go to court, you got, there's a docket, your name's on the thing, you gotta come before the judge, you stand before the judge, and they're like, bam, 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 these are the charges against you. So when we're praying and we're casting these devils out, we gotta go to the courtrooms of heaven and say, what are the charges against us? Well, your fourth uncle on your grandpa's side used to worship the devil. Okay. So because of that, curse down. Boom. 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 People don't like that. But I'm telling you, this is what happens. This is what we see. Right? So this is what we're doing. So what do? You as a man of God now, you as a covenant person, you as a body of Christ, you gotta stand in the gap. If my people who are called by my name, well, if you're part of this covenant, you're his people, so you go and you stand in the gap and say, Lord, I repent for me, I repent for my parents, I repent for my grandparents, and I repent for my bloodline all the way back to Adam. I've seen it with my own eyes. Once that repentance was done, that they believed. Because it has no more legal right. And in the courtrooms of heaven, with the judge, Jehovah, his word stands above all. Right? You're like, Apostle, you're talking crazy. No, let's go. We're going to go here. Psalm 106. Verse 6.
Jesus.
106, verse 6. This is King David. Go. I think I was going to do that whole thing, but I'll be okay. It says this: we have sinned with our fathers, and we have committed iniquity. We have done wickedly. Our fathers in Egypt did not understand your wonders. They did not remember the multitude of your mercies, but rebelled by the sea, the Red Sea. Verse 8 says, nevertheless, he saved them for his name's sake, that he might make his mighty power known. He rebuked the Red Sea also, and it dried up. So he led them through the depths as through the wilderness. He said, he saved them from the hand of him who hated them, and redeemed them from the hand of his enemy. The waters covered their enemies, and there was not one of them left. Then they believed his words, they sang his praise. Verse 13, here we go. It says, they soon forgot his words. They did not wait for his counsel, but lusted exceedingly in the wilderness, and tested God in the desert, and he gave them their request, but sent them leanness into their soul. When they envied Moses in the camp, and Aaron the saints of the Lord, the earth opened and swallowed Dathan, and covered the faction of Abiram. A fire was kindled in the company, the flame burned up the wicked. They made a calf in Horeb, and they worshipped the molten image. Thus they changed their glory into the image of an ox as they ate grass. They forgot God their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt. Wondrous works in the land of Ham, awesome things by the Red Sea. But therefore he said that he had not Moses had chosen one, stood before him in the breach. Let me read that one again. Had not Moses had his chosen one stood before him in the breach to turn away his wrath lest he destroy them. And so, this is King David. King David is saying, listen, we've sinned with our father. We keep going back and forth. Right? He revealed himself. He did wondrous works, mighty works. He opened the sea and ate the enemies. He destroyed all them. But guess what? He soon forgot. And so what does that look like? That looks like a pattern of iniquity, a pattern of going back and forth. By the implication of repentance. This is King David. And I want you guys to go. You can read all the way to verse 48 and just go back and forth. The Lord forgave them, honored them, blessed them, and then they forgot. Again, over and over again, guess what happened? The Lord dealt with it. Why? Because of the forefathers. They were iniquity. I'm saying this because here, 2022, we're coming up against this stuff. We're coming up against situations that two generations, five generations. We used to go back four or five generations, but now we just go back to Adam because there's no way to tell where it's at unless we get a word of knowledge on it. Sometimes the roots are so big, it goes back 100 generations. So for time, we just say, Lord, we just repent. You know, for us, our parents, our grandparents, and then our bloodline all the way back to Adam. Sometimes we got to repent for what Adam did. In the Bible. You know, that sounds crazy. That's crazy. Deliverance is crazy. But the Lord said to do it. Right? Mark chapter 16. I think verse 16. He says, these signs will follow those who believe. You'll speak in new tongues. You'll cast out devils. You'll lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. And if you drink something poisonous, it will not hurt you.
Yeah.
Right? That's what the Lord told us to do. Simple as that. Okay, you want to keep up? Here we go. Jeremiah 14:2. So I'm teaching this because each one of you guys are ministers. Those of you guys that you want to learn more, than those of you guys that are coming up against this with your kids, coming up against this in your parents and your relatives at work, this is going to help you. Jeremiah 14 verse 2. Oh, yeah, here we are. 14 verse 2. And it started to. It says, Judah mourns, and her gates languish. They mourn for the land, and the cry of Jerusalem has gone up. Their nobles have sent their lads for water, and they went to the cisterns and found no water. They returned with the vessels empty, and they were ashamed and confounded, and covered their heads. Because the ground is parched, for there was no rain in the land. The plowmen were ashamed, and they covered their heads. Yes, the deer also gave birth in the field, but death because there was no grass. And the wild donkey stood in the desolate heights. They sniffed at the wind like jackals, and their eyes failed because there was no grass. That was a curse. Verse 7. It says this, O Lord, though our iniquities testify against us, do it for your name's sake. For our backslides are many. We have sinned against you. Well, the hope of Israel, his Savior, in time of trouble, why should you be like the stranger in the land and like a traveler who turns aside to tarry for a night? Why should you be like a man astonished, like a mighty one who cannot save? Yet you, O Lord, are in the midst, and we are called by your name. Do not leave us. It doesn't matter if somebody else taught you that there cannot be a curse on your bloodline. It doesn't matter. Because there can be. There's a curse on my life. There was things that I've done, but even there was things that my ancestors have done, and I didn't even know. I mean, and going through some ministry, and I'll tell you a little story. I was going through some ministry. I was going to, go to the doctor and get a procedure done, just a test. And as we were praying, one of the sisters, a prophet, she's like, I see a wishbone being broken. And I'm like, it didn't make sense. But then I remember, as kids, my dad would always come and be like, hey, who wants to break the wishbone? You guys ever heard of that? He's like, my dad was like, come here, who wants to break the wishbone on the turkey, on the chicken, whatever? And we'd go, well, let's go do it. Little kids, we'd go and break it, whoever gets the biggest size wins. Right? And then you're like, so this is something that my dad did. We were having fun. You know what I mean? But guess what happens? This, in ministry, when people were praying for my healing, this is what one of the prophets did. How would she get that? She don't know me. Didn't know that we were breaking wishbone. You know what I mean? But it was like, oh wow. So I had to repent. I had to repent for that. I had to repent for my parents. That's a voodoo. Serious. That's serious. That's considered breaking bones for wishes, making wish on bones, and this ain't nuts. But this is what we don't know. Right? Hosea 4:6, you can write this down. It says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. My people perish for lack of knowledge. Let's go there a little quicker. If I'm going to read that second part. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. Love it. People are destroyed for lack of knowledge. But this second part is where I wanted to go. He said, because you have rejected knowledge, I will also reject you from being priest for me. Because you have forgotten the law of your God, I will also forget your children. Because lack of knowledge. Because lack of knowledge, my people are destroyed. But the second part is so critical. It says, because you have rejected knowledge, I will also reject you from being preached for me. In the New Testament, in Revelation, it says this. He says, I will make you a priest and a king. But because of lack of knowledge, Hosea says, because you have rejected my knowledge, I will reject you from being a priest. That has lasting implications. Now, how long did that last? That could last all the way through your generation. Do I feel like there's some blockage in my life? Every time I come up for a harvest, I feel like I'm going to get ahead, and the enemy comes in and boom, tire breaks. The refrigerator breaks down. Bam, bam, bam. You got a late fee. You got this. And every time you're like right here to get breakthrough, and guess what? The enemy comes in and steals your harvest. Tell me, because there's a delay there, there's a setback, there's a curse on your phone. finances. Why? I mean, okay, this isn't even in, but let's go to Malachi chapter 3. People don't like this. They're like, they're preaching this stuff. I'm just reading the Bible. Malachi 3. Just tell me where I'm looking. Go to 3:8. 3 verse 8. It says, will a man rob God? With a question mark. Well, you know, it's like, really? Will a man rob? It says this. He says, yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? Next line, it says, in tithes and offerings. Verse 9, it says, you are cursed with a curse. For you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Verse 10, it says, bring all the tithes into my storehouse, that there may be found in my house, and try me now in this. But this is it. Listen, we'll put a curse on your finances if you don't bring a tithe. Now, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying if you don't bring a tithe, I'm a Christian. No, I'm not saying that. Malachi chapter 3, verse 9 says, no, I don't tell you, but I'm giving you the whole counsel of God, what are you saying? Then that's on me. All right. Let's go to Nehemiah chapter 1. What I'm doing is I'm trying to give you some references to identificational repentance in the Bible. Now, sure, the word identificational repentance isn't in here, but sins of the Father is. Iniquity is. Now, I'm not trying to take another offering. I'm not doing that. I wasn't even going to go there. You could even check my notes. Nehemiah chapter 1. I hope you guys are learning some stuff on this. Listen, God, how many of you guys want to be great experts? I do. How many of you guys want to be great in the kingdom of God? I do. You know, I mean, that's all. Well, that's prideful. I mean, who don't want to be like their papa? I walk like my dad. I talk like my dad. You know what I mean? On earth, that's who we identify with, and that's. But my spiritual papa is a king.
Amen.
He created the heaven and earth with his word. We don't want to be like that. You know what I mean? We don't want to be like that. Now, we're not trying to take the Lord, but we're just going to do this. So here we go. Nehemiah 1. It says, the word of Nehemiah, the son of Hekali, the words of Nehemiah, the son of Hekali, it came to pass in the month of Shislev, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the citadel, that Hanani, one of the brethren, came with men from Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity, concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, the survivors who are left from the captivity in the province are there in great distress and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire. So there was right on. So what the word that was coming tonight, okay? It says, so it was then when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned for many days as I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven. And I said, I pray, Lord God of heaven, O great and awesome God, you who keep your covenant and mercy with those who love you and observe your commandments. It says, please let your ear be attentive and your eyes open that you may hear the prayer of your servant, which I pray before you now, day and night, for the children of Israel, your servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against you, both my father's house and I have sinned. We have cried very corruptly, or we have acted very corruptly against you, and have not kept the commandments, the statutes, nor the ordinances which you have commanded your servant Moses. Remember, I pray, the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though some of you who are cast out to the farthest part of heaven, yet I will gather them from there and bring them to the place which I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. Now these are your servants and your people whom you have redeemed by your great power and your strong hand, O Lord. I pray, please, that your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servant who desire to fear your name, and let your servant prosper this day. I pray and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. What is that saying? He was a cupbearer, but what is he saying? First off, I love it. Verse 1, he says, yes, the guys that survived, they escaped and they survived, and they're in Jerusalem. Well, he's stuck in captivity, right? And he's like, what happened? I mean, he probably hadn't seen them for however many years. And he's like, how are they doing? Are they surviving? Are they doing okay? He's like, the ones that escaped are there, but they're in much reproach. You know what I mean? It says that, I want to read that again, because it says, the Jews who have escaped, who had survived the captivity and concerning Jerusalem, they had said to me, the survivors who are left from the captivity in the provinces are there in great distress and reproach. And the wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and the gates are burned with fire. Let's just write that down. Great distress and reproach. And then they're probably getting ravaged or probably. How many of you have a city without walls? What is that? It's open, wide open to the enemy. Come see. You know, these people, he's like, you wanted to hear about the ones that escaped. Well, they're still there, but they're in great distress. They need help. The walls are broken down. The gates are torn down. People are able to come in and take their spoils, take what they got. He begins to cry, weep to the Lord, and say, Lord, I know you said, Lord God, if we sin, that you would scatter us. But I have sinned against you. My fathers have sinned against you, Lord. Please remove the curse. If you keep on reading Nehemiah, the Lord found favor in their heart. The king actually, because he was the cupbearer, the king actually wrote a letter and gave him the wood to give him everything to go and build back the gates, build back the walls, build back their lives to be able to bring them back up. But it was because he came and repented. So, what does that look like then in 2022? That's repenting on the behalf. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray, then the Lord, then I will hear from heaven. He will come. He will come and heal the land. So, what does that look like? What does that sound like? That sounds like deliverance in 2022. Casting out the spirit of addiction, casting out the spirit of witchcraft, casting out the spirit that has caused them, the spirit of poverty that has caused them to be in great distress, in great reproach, with the gates torn down, with the walls torn down. But he said, listen, if my people who are called by my name, you guys, deliverance ministers, you guys as men of God, women of God, if you know, he says, for my people, for lack of knowledge, they will be destroyed. Proverbs 11, it says, through knowledge, my people will be delivered. How will they know unless you don't go? So when you're praying and you know, they may not know, but you know, be like, listen, we need to walk you through some repentance. You're like, I'm not mad at nobody. Yeah, but let's still do it anyway. Forgive their parents, forgive their grandparents, whatever. And then guess what happens? The enemy, the hole will begin to leak. The curse will begin to break. So brought that all the way to saying, listen, Identification and repentance is necessary. A lot of people don't like the way we do deliverance, but it works. You know, people, you know, they're like, oh, well, it's done wrong. Well, it worked. Jesus didn't say, oh, well, you have 5 points of deliverance. You're supposed to do this, a spin, backflip, fall on the ground, and you'll be delivered. He didn't say that. He said, go. Matthew 28 says, go into all the nations, making disciples of all men, teaching them everything that I've taught you. We learn how to do it. Holy Spirit is our guide, right? So, this is what I mean. Sometimes we're like, we call each other, be like, I'm stuck. I'm praying with this person and it's stuck right here. What do I do? You walk them through repentance. You walk them through sins of the Father. You walk them through iniquities. Boom, 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 and they'll get delivered. Okay, question. Anybody got a question? Yes, ma'am.
Our family used to do the wishbone thing back in the day. Could it like be as simple as that for like an open door?
Yeah.
Wow.
It could be. I mean, it's we say simple, but that ain't simple. Because literally, I mean, you know, when you're doing witchcraft, people, they throw bones and they'll get your future. That's really it's basically you're partnering with really witchcraft, the demonic.
So,
go ahead.
In alignment with that, we discovered birthday candles.
Yeah.
How many of us, you know, the wishing, that wishing you want?
Yeah. Some of us wish. See, so if you read that, you research birthday candles?
Mm-hmm.
Anything done with fire is the root of that is that they would light candles to rid off of the evil spirits. Well, for their birthday or something like that. So what happens is you make that an idol. Anytime you go to something else other than God for protection. 2022, this is what we're finding out. So we can research and learn. Like now, we'll sing happy birthday, but we ain't got no truth. Yeah. No, I mean, like you said, can it be as simple as that? It could be. You know what I mean? What I know is the Bible says this. It's in Romans 6:16. It says, whatever you submit your members to, you become a slave. So if I say, there's a candy bar right there, and I go and eat that candy bar, does that bring a curse? What happens if I do that every day? I open the door. You know what I mean? So it's that understanding of what happens. Anybody else?
I have one more, sorry.
Go ahead.
On finances, and I'll just use myself as an example, put myself on blast. And you guys kind of know a lot of my story now. You guys talk my journey with me, but I used to, I guess I'm just going to say, at Walmart and Supers, you know, you got a pack of meat. One's $11, the other one's $11, and you're going and you're scanning, and oops, both of them went in there. Well, for me, that was the Lord convicted me like crazy. And it was when the finances weren't coming in. And it was like, what is that? That's stealing. Like, flat out stealing. And so, like, in your finances, when they're not coming in, evaluate what you're doing. Because I'll tell you what, the Lord even took me through that of what are you doing. And He showed me so many things, even back to when we were a kid. I mean, not this is a kid, totally putting us on blast. We would go at our recreation center, and we would go steal persons. And we would take money and dump their purse in the trash. The Lord had me go all the way back to repent for that. And it was, but guess what? Like, my brothers and my sisters can catch Lord will reveal and listen, you know.
Yeah, and so as the Lord reveals it to you, say, you might have a dream, or sometimes you'll think about something like, why didn't you even get to that? You know what I mean? And so you're like, Lord, and then so it happens all the time. And so I say I go through deliverance like every 6 months. Because stuff opens up and I have to repent. I'll get a dream and like I did this when I was six. So I have to repent for it because why is the Lord showing me? So guys, we're gonna end up with prayer or we're gonna walk. But tell the devil and your place is wet clean and he comes back, he'll come back 7 times
worse.
The Lord says to just forgive. He said that he was telling us to forgive 7 times 7, which means like, but I mean, I believe there's also a time where, I mean, I don't know when the Lord will stop, but I haven't found that time. I haven't, you know what I mean? I it never happened to me before. I'm not saying do what you're doing. I'm just saying that we gotta walk our walk. Fear and trembling. You know what I mean? In that stuff. Okay, Father God, right now, thank you, Lord. I ask that you would fill this word. Everything that we've got out, Lord God, I ask that you would come with me, Lord. Lord God, I rebuke the enemy right now off of this word.
Yeah.
That it would be able to sit, Lord God, that it would take root. Lord God, that your people, your leaders, Father God, would be able to